guess it's still morning, right?
Yes.
I'm glad to be here for a few minutes. Glad to be here. So we're going to talk today about water deficiency disease formation. Let it rain. You know, Lee and I were talking about what would I talk about this year. And threw out a couple things, and finally it hit me one day that I really pushed my patients to drink a lot of juice, you know? I just, you know, juice, smoothies. And yes, I tell them to drink water, always. I tell them how much to drink, you know, at least your body weight divided by two. And we talk about that, but I never really stress it. And then it hit me that when it rains, it never rains juice. It always rains water. Why is that? Why would God not give us juice in the rain? Since juice is so important. But God chooses to give us water. Maybe he knows something that we don't know. Well, the fetus is 100% water, they say. And then when the baby is born, it's at least 80%. Some statistics will say even up to 90% water. The adult, 60 to 70%, men seem to be a little more than women. And as you age, the water decreases. Now, I want you to know that all changes that occur during the aging process are not physiologic. What do I mean by that? See, we think that aging is normal, all right? That you just normally will grow old, and you'll normally develop arthritis, and you'll normally develop high blood pressure, you know? The only thing normal is that your hair will fall out. You know, these things are not normal, you know? They come as a result of our lifestyle. I believe, and I didn't have time to really check it out. Well, I did discover some that much of the dehydration that occur in aging is because we aren't taking in adequate water. But I wasn't able to find someone who really studied this to see what the maximum level of elderly could be with water. But as I said, men about 60%, women about 55 to 60%, and children about 70% water. Not juice, water. Now, how is this water distributed in the body? Well, there's this intracellular within the cell, you have water. And about 2/3 of the water in the body is actually intracellular. And then you have this extracellular water, all right? Water that's outside of the cell. And so here, the extracellular water is all the water outside, and the inside, intracellular is that liquid found inside the cell. And I've broken down the extracellular for you so you get a better understanding. So we have the plasma, we have the interstitial, water, we have the cellular fluids. And inside these organs, we have the gastrointestinal juices, we have the cerebrospinal, we have the peritoneal, and even in the eye, you know, you get dry eye because you don't have water. All right? And so water is important for so many things. And so, when you drink this water, it goes in the stomach, intestines and just is distributed throughout the body. The body is very efficient in taking in water. And so I wanted to look at just how this is regulated. You know, and what you see is that God is awesome. He's put in several methods to regulate, making sure we have adequate water. There's a hormone in the posterior pituitary. It's called the ADH, the antidiuretic hormone. What does it mean to diaphorese? Is to put out, right? Put out water. You know, you take a diuretic to do what? Get rid of water. Well, the body has an anti-diuretic, all right? An anti-diuretic hormone. And there's a disease called diabetes insipidus. Diabetes insipidus. And this form of diabetes, you know, with sugar diabetes, we pass a lot of urine, right? And that's because the what? The glucose is real high, and the body's trying to get that glucose out of the system, and so with that goes the water. Well, this antidiuretic hormone is trying to keep the body from getting rid of water, and it regulates how much water you release. And it's, as I said, it's in the posterior pituitary, and I've only seen one case of antidiuretic hormone. One case, and that was a young boy when I was a resident who had a tumor in the pituitary, and we'd have to come every day and inject him this antidiuretic hormone so he would not put out all of his water and of course die. There's also in the area of the kidney, the adrenal cortex, it produces aldosterone, and in the heart, the heart is even involved with controlling water. And there's a peptide that's found in the heart that helps to regulate water, sodium, potassium, and even fat in the heart. All right, and so I've given a little diagrammatic here that shows some of these areas that control the water. The brain, the posterior pituitary, the heart, and the kidneys. And actually, it's above the kidneys you have the adrenal gland, which is really not shown here, and in that you have the adrenal cortex. Now, every major chemical reaction that occurs in the human body occurs through water. Every major chemical reaction that occurs in the body involves water. What I wanted you to see from this is that water is important, because we're just a bunch of chemical, electrical, magnetic reactions. That's all we are, you know? And with those reactions comes water. Now, how does the body use water? What are the functions? Or what is digestion? You know, when you start chewing, you get what? Saliva. Matter of fact, just smelling the food, the saliva starts flowing, right? You know, we are fearfully and wonderfully made. The body is preparing us to eat. And in that saliva, we have some enzymes that starts the digestion of that food. The saliva also helps to get the food down the esophagus, so it doesn't get stuck. So that water is involved in that process. And then it mixes with these digestive enzymes that's made in the stomach. They're the digestive enzymes. And it involves water. And the intestines, the most of the digestion actually occurs in the small intestine. And of course you have all these enzymes, water is involved with that. The liver puts its hormones in there's this, an area called the ampulla of Vata. The ampulla of Vata. And here, let me see, I may even have a picture. It's right in here. You have the small intestine, the duodenum. You have the pancreas, not shown here. You have the gallbladder, but you have the cystic duct from the gallbladder. You have the hepatic duct, and then you have the pancreatic duct. All of them meet and put these enzymes into the small intestines where the digestion occurs. And all of them involve what? Water. All of them involve water. So here you look at the various organs that's involved. All of them involve water. There's a process that occurs in the body called hydrolysis. Hydro is water, lysis is to break apart. Hydrolysis involves a separation of water into hydrogen and in a hydroxyl group. And then this goes to form reactions with other substances like sucrose. Sucrose is a what? A sugar. And the sucrose forms fructose and glucose. Now, why is that important? Because the body uses these to function. The brain uses glucose and ketones. That's it. That's what the brain uses, all right, to feed itself. And so this process involves water. And here's just showing you can do it in the laboratory, but naturally it occurs in nature. Another function of the body is to get rid of waste. To get rid of waste. When we eat, when various processes occur in the body, waste is produced. And water is needed to get rid of these wastes. Many of the wastes are what we call the nitrogenous waste, waste involving nitrogen. They go to form urea, and then this urea is evacuated through the bladder. All right, and some of these wastes, showing how I put this in because it just show how awesome we are. The body takes some of this waste and uses it to create energy. So it doesn't waste everything, you know. It uses what we have. And these are some of the systems in waste. The urinary system, the liver is involved with the bile through the gallbladder to the bile. The kidney is involved. The lungs is involved with waste. We breathe, all right? Out waste, people sweat, and of course the digestive tract and down through the colon and on out through the rectum and anus. Now, when we think about the function of water, water is used for electrical signals to travel through the brain, all right? And when you have a lack of water, then it could lead to weakness in the muscles, it could lead to disorientation, it could lead to hallucination, all right? And this occurs because when the brain loses ability to function, if you don't have adequate water. The brain needs water in order to function. And I'll come back to that in a minute a little bit more. But water is also used as a cushion, it's used as a lubricant. You know, all the cells of the body are cushioned with water. So it helps prevent friction. You know, before they develop respirators, babies, if they were born too prematurely, would die. And they would die because there's a fluid that surrounds the lung, you know, called surfactant. Surfactant. And surfactant is like soap and water. It's like soap and water. But what does it do? It allows the lung to move. All right? When you take a deep breath, the lung will move. And you know how to even feel it, or you don't feel it. You know, you assume that it's happening, but it's moving because surrounding this lung is a film of water, all right, that allows the lung to move, and it's called surfactant. If that's not produced, the lung will sort of cleave to itself, and the baby would die. So with the respirator, they were able to keep them alive until the surfactant is produced, because it's produced actually late in the process. And so this lubricant is very, very important. Water is used to regulate the temperature of our body through evaporation, all right? So when you sweat, you have a built-in air conditioner, okay? You know, and when it's cold, the body keeps the water in to preserve it, to help to warm up the body. You notice when you get close to your spouse in bed, they're warm. The body has an air conditioner, but it also has an oven, all right, a furnace. And so it regulates this through water. And water lubricates not only the lungs, but the esophagus, the heart, the around the heart is a pericardium, and there's this pericardial fluid. In the abdomen, you have fluid, you know, in the peritoneum, and then in the urogenital area, there's also fluid. Now, this is a plant. It's actually a tomato plant. And I asked the question, where did the water go? Because you can see back here, a couple of the plants still are vibrant. But when the water is removed, the plant just sort of what? Shrivels up. Now I want you to put yourself in the place of that plant. All right? And when you are not giving yourself adequate water, inside you are doing what? Shriveling up. In fact, when a patient comes into the emergency room or comes into the office and we want to find out if they're dehydrated, one of the first things we do is we check their skin. We call it skin turban, you know? And we pinch it and it sort of stays up. We say, oh, you need some more water. Because normally when you pinch, it should drop right back down, you know? Good elasticity. But if you pinch it and it just sort of stays up the little tip, dehydration. And so I wanted you to see in this plant, I love plants, you know? And I'm always checking my plants. This morning before I came here, I went out, I got on my porch, got all these flowering plants, you know? And I watered them before I left. Why? Because they need water. If they don't get it, they will die. If you don't get it, you will die. Now, this, it's hard to pronounce his name, so let's call him Dr. B. Dr. B is an Iranian. I had to pronounce some of you good. Baclofen, okay. He's an Iranian physician. And very prominent doctor, to the point that when there was a takeover in Iran, he was put in prison. All right, he was put in prison, you know, as part of the opposition. And I think he was there about 2 years. And being a physician, doctors like to do what? Treat. All right? If you see a problem, you want to treat it. But he didn't have any medicines that he was used to using. There was no scaffolds so he could operate. And so what did he use? He used water. And he treated over 3,000 prisoners with water. You know, they had ulcers, they had pain, they had a whole bunch of diseases, and he found how powerful water was in treating the disease. And he wrote a book, it's something like, you aren't hungry, you're thirsty, all right? It's something like that. I forget the exact name, but it's saying that oftentimes we think we're hungry, the body is really calling for water, and we need to give it water. You know, sometimes at night, you know, I don't like to eat late at night, and I feel a little hungry, so instead of eating, I go and drink some water, and I feel good, and I go right to bed, right to sleep. You know. And your stomach, you don't wake up the next morning and stomach all upset and everything. So he peptic ulcers, diabetes, type 1 and type 2. Diabetes associated with water deficiency. So many of the diseases that we're suffering from right now could be reversed with diabetes. As a result of studying this fellow, I now tell all of my patients, I want you to take a teaspoon of sea salt, and put it in a gallon of water and drink at least half your body weight every day. I mean, I tell them, look, if you don't do anything else, get you a teaspoon of sea salt, put it in a gallon of water, and drink at least half your body weight every day. And when they fuss, I tell them to shut up and do it. No, I don't say that, but sometimes I do. You know, depending on who the patient is. But that's what we need to do. We need to do that. The other thing I tell them to do is sprint 8, which is exercise. All right? I tell them to get on the bicycle and warm up for 3 minutes and then sprint for 30 seconds. And then cool down for a minute and a half, and then sprint for 30 seconds, and cool down for a minute and a half, and sprint, and do that 8 times. All right? I tell them, do those two things, and if you do those two things, you're going to see a significant improvement in the health. Your blood pressure is going to go down, your weight's going to go down, the diabetes is going to get better, you're going to stimulate your immune system, all by drinking water and eating. He even found that it helped patients with HIV. Why? Because water is involved with the immune system, and so it improves the immune system. Now, when we become dehydrated, there's an inhibition of the effectiveness of the lymphatic system, and the lymphatics is what builds our immune system. And so, just by not doing that, also, it slows the elimination of cellular waste. So you can't get that waste out. If you can't get that waste out, the body then has to react to it. So it's using its immune system to fight the waste instead of you getting the waste out just by drinking water. Have you noticed that when you drink water, you urinate more? Have you noticed that your bowels move better when you drink water? Sometimes patients call me and they say, Dr. Watkins, what can I do for my bowels? I said, drink some water and call me back if that doesn't work. You know, they want what? They want some medicine. Instead of giving them medicine, well, I do give them medicine, but I give them natural medicine, water. Now, dehydration, I told you I was going to talk about this brain a little bit more because, you know, as we get older, we're worried about our brains, right? One of the best things you can do for your brain is drink water. But I wanted you to understand it a little bit. See, it's been shown that dehydration has a negative effect on the brain. It contributes to the development of what? Depression. You never thought that not drinking water would make you depressed. All right? What happens is there's a decrease in blood volume that goes to the brain. Blood is made up mainly of what? Water. And so if you're dehydrated, your blood is contracted and it doesn't move as well, it's thick. It also will form clots and all kind of other things that can occur when the blood is thick like that. But one thing that happens, you get a decrease in blood supply to the brain, and with the blood comes the glucose, which we said is very important for feeding the brain. And because that glucose is delivered by the blood. And so, if you don't get adequate blood to the brain, you don't get adequate nutrients to the brain, and you get headaches, you get diminished memory, you get impaired thinking. You can't even think clearly because you're not drinking enough water. Now, these nerves are very sensitive to dehydration, and if you become too dehydrated, once these nerves die, they can't regrow. All right? And so it's very, very important. And some of us have been, seems like we've been dehydrated a long time because we ain't thinking too clearly. your husband, your wife, you say, now you tell them, honey, you need to drink some water. They won't know what you. Don't tell them what I told you. Just say, honey, go drink some more water. You know? I think you're going to feel better. All right? But see, what they found is that there's these micro streams that exist along the whole length of the nerve. And they transport these nutrients into these microtubules where messages are transmitted. And so it's very important that we give the body adequate water so that it can do its job. We're fearfully and wonderfully made, and God made us that way. So when you become dehydrated, these messages are disturbed. And so you sometimes you'll feel pain. That's why Dr. B treated all these people with pain with water. Whether it's pain in the stomach, pain in the joints, all of these areas, water. Low energy, lack of muscle strength, poor endurance. All right? Histamine. We've heard of histamine, right? Histamine is a neurotransmitter. It carries messages through the nervous system, the brain and the nervous system. And one of the functions of histamine is to encourage the intake of water. Histamine stimulates you to drink water, all right? But we've also found that some people who have asthma, depression, chronic pain, have high levels of histamine, all right? And so what do? We give them antihistamines. You know, I remember when I was in my third year of medical school, I started developing these headaches. And I noticed that when I went to the chief of neurosurgery, and I asked him, why would God let me come this far to get a brain tumor? And he told me to shut up and quit diagnosing myself. And he evaluated me, and it turns out that it was sinusitis, which caused this vasculitis. And so wherever I went, I had neosinephrine. What is neosinephrine? A antihistamine. And I wanted that because it would get rid of the pain. And I want to get rid of the pain. And so I would use neosinephrine, all right? But what I was doing also, I was cutting off the signal that my body gives out to drink water. the signal for thirst through the histamine. And so if you're using all these histamines, you need to stop and find natural ways to treat your allergies and so forth. Oftentimes, changing your diet will make a big difference. And drinking plenty of water, getting off the sugar, all these things will contribute to that. Water makes up about 60 to 70% of weight, depending on the age. But when you become obese, it decreases the percentage of water, sometimes as low as 45%. And so just by gaining weight, you're becoming more and more dehydrated. From 60 to 45, that's a lot, all right? That's a lot. And so, you know, that's 1/4. We need to do something about that. All right, now, these are some of the processes that water is involved with. Metabolism, transportation, excretion, perspiration, lubrication, respiration, and many, many other functions that the body uses water for. So I want to stop right there, ask any questions that you might have about water. You know, the next to oxygen is the most abundant nutrient that we have in the body. Yes, ma'am.
Switch the switch up.
You mentioned that nerves can become dehydrated and die.
Yes.
Is it any possibility to grow new nerves in the body?
We are told that we have all the nerves at birth that we will ever have. So that essentially we can't grow new nerves. I think what I'm hoping is that the nerves are not dead, but just sort of asleep. Because I've found that people who've had strokes even, that with various exercises and things, we can get them to regain function. And so, and regain sensation. And so I believe in that situation that the nerve was not completely dead, it was just sort of stunned. And with proper treatment, it was revived. Yes, right here.
To drink half your body weight per day, does it make a difference if you drink most of it in the morning as you start your day, or should you spread it out throughout the day?
Well, you have to develop a formula for yourself that works. A lot of people will start the day off by drinking like a quart of water, you know, in the morning with a little lemon juice. The lemon is very good because it gives some minerals, and those minerals help to alkalinize the water, and that alkalinized water seems to be even more effective. And so, but what you want to do is see how your body handles it, you know. You don't want to just pour the water down, you want to drink the water so that the water can be absorbed into the system, all right? So I would spread it out. You may drink a bolus in the morning, but then spread it out throughout the day. Yes.
We are told all the time that we should drink from 8 to 10 ounces of water a day. Or glasses of water. What would you say consider the minimal amount of glasses?
What we recommend is half the body weight. And so that 8 to 10, I've not used that for a long time. You know, and if the average, if a person weighs 160 pounds, for instance, and then you divide that by two, that's 80. That means that person needs 10 glasses of water. All right? And so, you know, if you're around 140 pounds, you need a little more than 8 glasses of water. So between 140 and 160 pounds, that would be adequate. But if you're over that, you need much more water. Some people need almost a gallon of water a day just for basic, take care of basic needs, all right? And it's always actually better to drink more than less. You better drink more than less, yes.
So now my brother has about 23% of his heart function, and my neighbor's son has about 26. They're both overweight, they both drink a lot of liquids. And I don't think they're drinking a lot of water, but now they're limiting their liquid intakes. Seems strange.
Well, no, it's not strange. What's happened is that the heart is weak, and the heart becomes overworked if it has too much, if the workload is too great. And so what has to happen, we have to rebuild the heart. And one of the things that I've found is that you can do that. You know, I take people with congestive heart failure, I tell them I want you to walk an hour and a half or 2 hours. And they look at me like I'm crazy, Dr. Watkins. I can't hardly walk across the room. And I said, that's why you need to walk an hour and a half. But, you know, I give them what I call the Watkins version of interval exercise. In that I tell them, you walk until you start to get tired. You stop, you rest. You walk until you start to get tired. You stop, you rest. You walk until you start to get tired. You stop, you quit. You come back the next day and you repeat the process. So what's happening in that process, you are strengthening your heart, all right? You're expanding your lungs. Also, we've changed their diet, all right? And we have them, you know, giving them other nutrients that, you know, like coenzyme Q10, for instance, the B vitamins, that's gonna help to strengthen the heart. Minerals, foods high in minerals, you know, we have to start juicing, you know? So those things, we give them that water with sea salt, which also gives minerals, so we can build the heart back up. And then they can walk more, and they can drink more. You know, people with kidney failure, they can't drink a lot initially, but as we start building their kidneys back up, they can drink. And if you get the kidneys before it gets too far gone, we've been able to reverse kidney failure. In many instances, but we got to get it before it's too far gone, because there comes a point of what appears to be no return. I believe God can do anything. All right, so He can do it. But the problem is that we want God to do His part, but we don't want to do our part. And what I found is that don't work too good. God is waiting to see if you're really serious. If you start doing your part, like by coming here, that's part of that. And so that's very, very good.
How about tap water versus spring water versus purified or distilled water?
When it rains, it does not rain tap water. It does not rain spring water. It rains what? Distilled water. All right? And so I recommend distilled water. But distilled water has minerals, Dr. Watkins. Praise the Lord. I mean, it has no minerals. Praise the Lord. All right? You get your minerals from your food. God didn't give us water to get minerals. God gave us water to get what? Water. All right? And so tap water, the reason we don't promote tap water is because it's a little dirty. You know, and if you don't believe it, get a distiller and run that tap water through that distiller for a week or so. And if you can drink tap water after that, one of my church members took me home with him He had a distiller, an extra distiller, and he wanted me to buy it. When I saw what came out of that water, I quickly bought that distiller. Because it was just filthy. And it came out of the tap. I was on a program with Dick Gregory one time. And you know, Dick Gregory was crazy. And so he said, distill is the best water. If you can't get distilled, get spring water. If you can't get spring water, get the water from the tap and boil it and kill some of the organism. If you can't boil it, take the water from the tap, put it on the floor, and when the dog drinks it, you drink it. And the point he was making there is that, you know, they put chlorine in the water to purify it, and that chlorine has negative effects. And so, but it's a gas, and it'll escape if you let it sit for a while. That was the point. But the best water is distilled water, and you put some mineral salt, you know, sea salt in it. Sea salt is much better than regular salt, all right? But it was interesting to prepare for this. I did a lot of reading, and one of the things that I read was that they tell you not to eat salt, but there's not been one study to show that salt has a negative effect on blood pressure. In fact, there have been two studies to show that when you drink, use more salt, the blood pressure actually goes down. Now, I'm not telling you to go out here and eat a whole lot of salt other than sea salt, but I'm going to check that into that more. But it was a very good physician that I respect that said that, so I'm going to look into it a bit more. But sea salt in that water will make a difference. Yes, ma'am.
Dr. Watkins, is there a danger in drinking too much water?
Is there a danger in drinking too much water? Yes, there is. But you got to drink a whole lot of water. Get too much. That anti-diuretic hormone, you can drink so much water that you deplete the anti-diuretic hormone. And if you read in the literature, that will give you that diabetes insipidus, where you just wash out all the anti-diuretic hormone, and so the body can't control your urine, and you just pee out all your water. But like I said, I've only seen one case of that, and that wasn't from drinking too much water. All right, that was from the cancer. So if you have congestive heart failure, if you have kidney failure, even advanced liver failure, then you have to regulate how much water you take, because you'll overtax the organs. But as I said earlier, you can build up so you get to a place you can take in more. Yes.
Dr. Watkins, you said to take a teaspoon of sea salt, a gallon of water, drink half your body weight daily. Are you saying to do this regularly, or
yes,
this,
ma'am?
This is not if there's some challenge. This
no,
is
just
salt
daily.
Daily.
Yeah. Okay.
Dr. Watkins, that's just with distilled water, so if you're drinking.
I think you need to add the sea salt at any rate, because the sea salt contains a lot of the nutrients. And one of the points that Dr. B made, and then I've read a number of other people who also recommend this. Dr. B says that when you drink water with the sea salt, well, let me back up. Normally when you drink water, that intracellular space is replenished, but the extracellular is not replenished as effectively. But when you drink the salt water, then it holds the water in abeyance, and you develop a balance between the intracellular and the extracellular, and so that's why it's recommended that way. Right here.
There's that teaspoon of salt per gallon have any impact in respect to thought that I'm thinking of purging the water of the chemicals that's in there, or that's inserted into water, such as chlorine, or dissipating the water.
Oh, I see what you said. I don't think the purpose of the sea salt is for that. The purpose of the sea salt is to replace the minerals in the body and to help to regulate the concentration of the water inside and outside the cell.
Now, does that have any impact with the pure distilling?
Well, we take in minerals all the time, and so the body needs minerals, but it needs minerals in the right form. And so it's not that minerals are bad; it's that when we take the minerals into the right and wrong form, they're bad. For instance, I don't recommend that my patients go and take calcium. I don't recommend my patients go and take magnesium. I recommend that my patients go and juice and get the minerals through the juicing, you know, because when we take it, the isolated minerals, that's not the way the body is geared to handle it. And so you're going to deplete something else. But if you take it in a balanced way, the body can handle it much, much better. And so the same thing with the sea salt. The sea salt is a much more balanced solution, and the body can handle that quite well. If you take coconut water, for instance, coconut water is also a balanced solution, and it's very, very good, and the body handles that quite well. Yes? Himalayan sea salt is extremely good. She was asking about the iodine. Yes, you can put the iodine in water. We talked about iodine last year. So you put, I recommend to all of my patients that they take 4 drops of Lugol's twice daily for I think 3 months, and then 2 drops daily. You know, and the 3 months is to build up, because as I mentioned last year, most of us are deficient in iodine, so we need the iodine. So these are just things, and it's natural. And you put it in the water, and you get very good results. The Himalayan water already has some iodine in it, as you know. The sea salt has some iodine in it, but I recommend even more because we tend to be so deficient in iodine. Yes, ma'am.
I would like to know about the well water.
Well water?
Yes.
Well water is so dependent upon the environment. You know, you have these aquifers that are feeding the well. And if they're coming from areas that are polluted, the well water will be polluted. All right? And so you have to test the well water. Some well water is fine, and some well water is not good. So you have to test it just to make sure, understand the source. I remember when I was in medical school, I didn't watch a lot of TV, but one day there was a Bill Moyers journal on, and it was talking about this natural setting where people were going to get this mountain stream water. And it was just so crystal clear and cool coming from the mountain, way out of the middle of nowhere. But somebody decided to test the water. Why would you test water out in the wilderness? But they tested the water, and guess what they found? Pesticides in the water. Where did pesticides come in this mountain water? Ain't no trees up in the mountains. Well, I guess there are trees. But what they found out was that they had aerosprayed the area. And when it rained, it washed the pesticides down into into the ground, it got into the aquifer, and came out in this beautiful, cool, crystal water. All right? And so we have to test the water if we aren't sure of its source.
Yes, you mentioned distilled water, spring water, and tap water. What about filtered water? And would you spell that iodine?
The iodine is Lugol's, L-U-G-O-L, possibly S, Lugol's solution, L-U-G-O-L, possibly S. I brought up a few samples for someone some people asked me last year about it. I did bring some with me. Filtered water. Filtered water is certainly much, much better than tap water. But it also depends on the type of filtration. All right? And there are different kinds of filtration. And I'm not an authority on it, but I know people use charcoal, people use different kinds of things to filter the water. Some do it with different layers, you know, to pull out some of the things. So it is certainly much, much better. We have filters on our water at home, you know. And so, you know, the ice box, the sink, you know, although I don't drink that water. But we have filters on it. Just the same, you know. So filtered water is much, much better.
I'm wondering if anything's wrong with this one. I buy about a case from Costco. It says purified drinking water.
What does that mean? See, the problem is, what does that mean? See, they're purified. What we have to find out is the process. If you go online, there's a video that talks about, and I don't remember the name of it, I saw it several years ago, talks about this bottled water. There was one company that was getting the water, and this was before the stuff in Flint came, but they were getting it straight from Michigan and running it straight into the bottle, put a nice little cute label on it. You know, we see these labels with the flowers, and the beautiful trees, you know, that doesn't change the content. That's just a picture, you know. And they use those things. I was telling a patient yesterday, they were asking about something. I said, well, honey, you got to read the label. You got to read the label. We don't read labels, you know. And then when you read the label, you have to understand what that means. I don't know what it means when they say purified. You know, so I need to call the company and find out, what are you saying when you say purify? You know, and then they'll tell you what that process is. Why is it important? I interviewed on my radio show some years ago now, a lady from the FDA, and they were just about to change labeling on food, all right? So she was talking about the process and so forth. And at the break, she didn't say it on air, but at the break, she told me, she said, Doc, you got to be careful with the word natural. She said, because you have to know what that means. She said, these companies can put as much salt in the product as they want and still call it natural. They can put as much sugar in a product as they want and still call it natural, because those things have been defined as being natural. And unfortunately, we can't always depend upon our government. All right? If you look on milk, or advertisement of milk, they'll talk about the FDA says that milk is good for your bones, and cheese is good for your bones. That is a bold-faced lie. It's been shown by a number of studies that when you drink milk, when you eat cheese, it actually makes you more likely to have osteoporosis and bone fractures. There was this major study, nurses study. I think they looked at some 20,000 nurses, all right? And the ones who drank the most milk and dairy products had the highest rate of bone fractures. So it's just the opposite. But that's consistent with many other studies that have been done to show the communities that drink the least amount of milk and dairy, use dairy products, have the least fractures, and the ones that drink the most have the most fractures and osteoporosis. And so labeling is important, but understanding labeling is even more important. All right. Yes, ma'am.
I'm asking about alkaline water.
Alkaline water has been overhyped. All right. If you want to put lemon juice in your water and call it alkaline water, great. If you want to put sea salt in your water and call it alkaline water, great, because both of those waters are alkaline. But there's some question as to this ionized process where it's just a chemical reaction to make it alkaline, and they get really high levels of alkalinity. There have been studies to show that that can actually be detrimental to your health. Now, I know a lot of people are pushing it, and they're making a lot of money, but you don't have to pay $5 for a bottle of water. You know, you can get your water quite alkaline and much, much cheaper by using some sea salt and other things like that.
Dr. Watkins, could you please comment on reverse osmosis water, please?
Reverse osmosis is another form of purification, and it's a very good form of purification. And so we highly recommend reverse osmosis. Thank you. Yes?
Yes, what about that apple cider, that pure apple cider?
Apple cider vinegar?
Yeah, in water.
Yeah, Bragg's apple cider vinegar, for instance. I know Bragg's is one that's a good form. It's not the white vinegar, it's the apple cider vinegar. It also alkalinizes the water, and I find it to be very effective. All right? All right, one more question over here. And then my son is gonna come up and it's going to give you some information about our website and some of the things that we want to do. Yes?
Explain what
alkalinity
water is going
for us. All right, so alkalinity has to do with pH, all right? Acid, base, neutral, all right? Neutral has a pH of 7, okay? And pure water is 7. If you put some sea salt or some lemon juice, it will give it a little higher pH. The body loves the pH of around 7.34, I think it is, somewhere around there. That seems to be the ideal function of the body. If the body is too acid or the body is too alkaline, then the body will be diseased, with dysfunction. And so you want a body a little alkaline, you know, and you can do that, as I said, with the minerals, with the sea salt. One of the things about this alkaline water, that I was reading some stuff, I actually looked at a video, and it said, You put this water that you paid $5 for into your stomach. The pH of your stomach is 1, the hydrochloric acid, and it's gonna just bring that alkaline water right on back down, the pH right on down. So the key is not the alkalinity, the key is those minerals, because the body can utilize the minerals. That's what it's using, not the pH. So that's what you wanna look at, Yes. You're great.
I wanted to ask about myself. I have a very dry mouth.
Yes.
But I know I take a lot of different medications, and they said that's where it's coming from. But what could I do about that, and what kind of water should I be drinking? My son gives me plenty of water on my face.
Okay, well, you brought up a very good point. A number of medicines will act as diuretics and will take water out of the system. And so you need to replace that water. And if you're taking a medicine that is a diuretic, you know, then you need to take more water in, all right? Now, sometimes you have conditions where you have a limited amount of intake. That's why you have to come to programs like this so that you have a balanced approach, all right? You need to really take in the right kinds of foods. You need to get proper rest. You need to decrease stress. All of those things have a major impact. I found that most diseases can be reversed if a person is willing to change. But you can't just do it for a couple days, a couple weeks even. You know, people say, well, what kind of diet do you put patients? I said, I don't use diets, all right? I change people's lifestyle. I expect them to do stuff for the rest of their life, you know? That's the way you get well, you know? I just had my 72nd birthday. Crazy enough. But I intend to be in better health my second, third birthday than I am my 72nd birthday. And you can do that if you work on changing lifestyle. You never become satisfied, all right? You want to, you know, walk. You want to laugh. You want to, you know, and start knocking things down just a little bit of time. How was the elephant eaten? One bite at a time. And see, sometimes we get weary and well-doing, all right? And so we need to make sure that we are making the proper changes, all right? And so that we can do this. And that's one of the things my son's gonna talk to you about. I've been very concerned about this. Now, Lee and I have talked about it many times. And so we're trying to harden her up with the Watkins Institute and what Lee is doing here in Allegheny. And helping people to get on a program and stay on the program, all right? Because getting started, you know, Shula says beginning is half done. It's important to begin, but you gotta continue. And so what we're doing is trying to help people to be able to continue to do things. And so we started a little program, we call it the Eden Connection. It's a health and fitness club, and my son will tell you a little bit about that and the overall things with the Watkins Institute. As usual, I always enjoy coming here. I'm excited, but I'm more excited when I see people who are making progress, all right? Who are making progress, because then we know that the drive down here was worth it, because you're serious about change, and you want to do it, and we can change. We can reverse these diseases. God is willing to do. And he'll do more than what you do, but he wants you to do your part. God bless, and we'll see you next time.